We have a series. The Tampa Bay Lightning win 6-2 in Game 3 of the 2022 Stanley Cup Final, defeating the Colorado Avalanche and making the series 2-1. Yes, Colorado still has home ice advantage. Yes, Colorado holds all the cards and controls their own destiny. But there have been many times over the last 3 years that the Tampa Bay Lightning have made me feel like they are destiny. Because what happened? In Game 2, the Tampa Bay Lightning lose 7-0 in Colorado. Everyone was obsessed with the 7, and after all, Colorado hung a touchdown on Tampa and Andrei Vasilevskiy, which is ridiculous. Ridiculous because that doesn't happen. But for me, the most concerning part for Tampa in that game and going forward is Tampa was able to generate nothing, zero, on offense. So I was asked, what has Tampa got to do different in this game? And what I said was, Tampa has got to throw it on. They got to throw it on from anywhere because they weren't throwing it on from anywhere. As they throw it on, they got to crash the net and they got to look for rebounds. And if the rebounds aren't there, Kemper will cover it up and at very least they'll get an ozone draw. Win the ozone draw and it's the same plan. Get it back to the point, have someone head to the net and make their lives difficult. Make the Colorado Avalanche's lives difficult. Make it so that Darcy Kemper can't see, etc., etc. If you take away his eyes, he's just some other goalie. And I was wrong. And you know why I was wrong? Because, like a lot of you, I forgot who the Tampa Bay Lightning are. Like, we were talking reckless as a hockey community. We were talking about how this is the first opponent the Tampa Bay Lightning have had in the Stanley Cup Final that was good. What? Like, okay, did I think that Dallas was going to make the 2020 Stanley Cup Final? No. They did! You don't fluke your way through 3 rounds! They did! With their backup goalie, they did! I did not think Montreal was going to make the Stanley Cup Final last year. They did! If the Stanley Cup playoffs were played on paper, it would have been Tampa versus Vegas twice. And the NHL said, best offer I can give you is Tampa versus the Islanders twice. Not the same! So let's talk about that game and I'll tell you the moment the series changed. First of all, before we even start, Cogliano still in the lineup, Burakovsky not for the Avalanche. Much bigger change for the Tampa Bay Lightning, Braden Point out, replaced by Riley Nash. Lord knows what Braden Point was playing at, like 40-30%? And the Lightning finally decided rather have a healthy body in there than a guy who knows what it's going to come out to when this series is over. Is Braden Point done for the season? He might not be, but you gotta think the rehab is going to be very long. Maybe even surgery. Who knows? He might not even be the only one. So, the game starts. Right away, you can tell Tampa looks different. Who knows what the factors are? Maybe it's the altitude getting better in Tampa. Maybe it's the fact that there's home ice advantage, the crowd. Whatever it is, Tampa actually had shots on goal in the first few minutes. But it would be Colorado who would strike first, the choo-choo train! What's happening? Oh, they're reviewing it. Oh, well, what's it for? Offside? Offside? Okay, well, let's have a look. Oh. You know, we criticize the refs a lot and like NHL player safety and the war room where they got to make decisions on stuff like this. I don't want to have to be the one to make a decision on that. We tend to go, oh yeah, you can see white on both sides of the puck. That means it's 100% offside. No! Man, you ever skated on ice? Snow! When you review, it needs to be definitive, like to overturn the call on the ice. Ooh. I thought that goal was gonna count. In real time, I thought that goal was gonna count. Maybe there's an angle that I haven't seen yet. I thought it was gonna count. They end up getting the call right, and it was a bit of a lengthy review, but producer Rob on the stream for Watch the Stanley Cup Playoffs with Steve Dangle said the review was 4 minutes and 15 seconds. It's long, but it's not too bad. It's under 5. The longest we've had in these playoffs was more than double that length. It was over 9 minutes. So a little over 4 is okay. So Colorado does not take the early lead. And then JT Compher takes a penalty. Oh my goodness, Tampa could have been down 1-0 and on the penalty kill. Now it's tied 0-0 and Tampa goes to the power play. Until Palat takes the high stick. And in the most unfortunate turn of events ever, at the end, the very, very end of 4-on-4 play, Tampa ices the puck and Colorado gets to begin their abbreviated power play right where they usually would in the offensive zone. And this This one counts. Gabriel Landeskog more in the blue paint than Andrei Vasilevskiy was. They're not going to review that one. It counts. 1-0 Colorado. Here we go again. There they go again. Between this goal and the 7 they scored in game 2 and the Burakovsky overtime winner in game 1, the Avalanche have scored 9 straight goals in this series. They are running away with it. The cup might as well be in the building tonight. But a few minutes later, Tampa gets a break. They get a bounce, or rather, not a bounce. Anthony Cirelli drives the net. He tries to go forehand, backhand on Darcy Kemper, but he accidentally, I'm pretty sure it was accidentally, you'd ask him, he might say he did it on purpose, but it was, he accidentally leaves the puck behind and basically does the Kucherov no move on Kemper. It goes through or under Kemper and in! All right, Cirelli gets the building going. So that's, you know, give credit to Tampa, and they got a bit of a bounce and they tied it up, but Colorado's gonna be fine. Now, this play, this coming up, is unacceptable. The play starts in the offensive zone for Colorado. They're in Tampa's zone. They win the faceoff. They get the puck back to the point and they flub the pass. And this is how it starts. It's a 2-on-2. And if it looks familiar, it should look familiar from game 1. This is Makar and Taves trying to guard Palat and Kucherov. Now, the first time around, Palat and Kucherov, torched these two. And sure enough, similar to last time, Palat and Kucherov going for the switch, but oh look, here's what makes it different this time. There's Mikko Rantanen on the back check. Colorado's got numbers, they're gonna be fine. Or at least they would have been if Rantanen did anything to anyone. What happens is Steven Stamkos joins the fray. He has the puck. Makar switches to Kucherov, Taves switches to Stamkos, Rantanen follows Stamkos and switches to no one. Open ice is where he switches. Stamkos gets a pass through to Palat, and it's a skilled pass. And this looks bad. This probably looks bad if you're Colorado. It's a great play by Tampa to make it 2-1, but yucky, gross defense from the Colorado Avalanche, from the standard that they've set. Tampa's gonna pick that apart every time. And that's how we go to intermission, but not before Nick Paul goes down funny, and I don't know if it was his ankle or groin, adductor, whatever it was. He needed help being carried down the tunnel, and I'm thinking there's no way Nick Paul's gonna get back in this game. This, to me, is where the series changes, because Nick Paul gets back onto the ice at the beginning of the second. He's hobbling at the beginning of the second. I can't believe he stayed in this game even after this shift. Ross Colton finds him in the high slot. Nick Paul, open somehow, even though he's the slowest player on the ice, grips it, rips it, past Kemper, 3-1. And I'll show you the moment the series changed. Look at this. Look at this. The determination on Nick Paul's face. Jan Rutta, that's just childlike glee. But Victor Hedman looked miserable, like a dejected puppy dog during game 2, and that is the face of a man with hope. Bonus points for this guy who, is it his real hair? I would believe it if you told me yes. For me, it was a similar sensation to when Steven Stamkos came back for, what was it, 6 shifts? Maybe? 3 shifts? Maybe? In the Stanley Cup Final in the bubble, and he scored. At the time, that series was tied 1-1, and that was game 3 as well. Stamkos comes down the wing, snipes it, and I knew in that moment there's not a chance Tampa doesn't win the Stanley Cup. Now, I'm not saying Tampa's gonna win the Stanley Cup because Nick Paul scored, but in that moment, I'm like, Tampa's winning this game. Now, it wouldn't be that easy because a little over 3 minutes later, Colorado gets another power play and another power play goal from Gabriel Landeskog. It's 3-2. But that's when the Lightning go up, up, and away. And they make a place that was impossible to get to in game 2, their home. Only a few minutes later, granted, it's a great pass from Kucherov and an even better receipt of the pass from Steven Stamkos. What on earth? That's Steven Stamkos, man! No one on him! No one in sight! And he rips it! Because he's Steven Stamkos! So now it's 4-2, the 2-goal lead is restored, and you got the impression that they weren't gonna let go of it this time. Not long after that, still in the second period, Patrick Maroon drives the net. He ends up scoring, and if he hadn't, there would have been another Lightning player that would have been second to the Nets. Now it's 5-2 in Tampa. Vasilevsky, it's the Stanley Cup final. That game is over. But then on the power play, defense on the power play is easier said than done, of course. But here's Corey Perry scoring from behind Darcy Kemper after Andre Palat's deflection almost goes in. In the second period, Tampa did whatever they wanted, whenever they wanted, however often they wanted to do it. And then it's the after the whistle stuff. The hits, the block shots, the clamping down on the slot, the Lightning like a boa constrictor every time you let out air to breathe, they squeeze a little tighter. You let the Lightning get a 2-goal lead if it's early enough, only if it's early enough, you might stand a chance. And Colorado was on their way to erasing it with that second Landeskog goal. Stamkos makes it 4-2. Go home. Go to the hotel. Prep for game 4. Make sure you have a nice meal. No one suffocates you like the Lightning. Said it before, I'll say it again. They're a team of skill guys with the work ethic of fourth liners. There is nowhere to hide. There's nowhere to rest. And in this game, as it got nastier down the stretch, they proved that the Avalanche have Josh Manson, and that's about it. No, like, they got other guys. Like, Nathan McKinnon's not afraid to go ya. Landeskog's not afraid to go ya. Cogliano obviously wanted some in that game, and Nazem Kadri gets in the lineup. I don't think he's gonna fight. He's got a busted hand, and same with Cogliano. But you know what I mean. Eric Johnson, Jack Johnson, those are big guys. But they're too key to what Colorado does. Whereas Tampa, every single player on that roster will go you. Nikita Kucherov might be the best forward Tampa has, and also their greasiest. And they have Corey Perry! Speaking of which, there was some nastiness down the stretch. Kucherov hammering Josh Manson a couple times. Taves with the cross check on Kucherov, and the way Kucherov bent was gruesome. Kucherov did leave this game early. I imagine it's precautionary. Victor Hedman with the very funny, not funny, funny kind of quote after the game. It's a dangerous play. We'll see if anything happens. Probably not. I mean, yeah. I would be stunned, jaw on the floor stunned, if anything happened to Devon Taves here. Even a fine? Maybe? Probably not. I don't think anything's going to come out of this game. But here's what I want to know going forward. Number one, Tampa adjusted. Can Colorado do the same? Like Nathan McKinnon, this is a great attitude. Nathan McKinnon remained upbeat following game 3. They didn't hang their head after losing game 2, and we're not going to tonight. Good or bad, we're not going to trade our spot with anyone in the world. We feel good about our team. He's right. I mean, after all, they're in the Stanley Cup final and they're winning it 2-1 currently. Worst case, Colorado leaves Tampa tied and they still have home ice advantage. Or you could look at it the way Tampa looked at it last year. Now you can win the cup at home. For Colorado, will Nazem Kadri be in game 4? Will he be a center if he does come back? How effective will he be at shooting the puck? All huge questions with one player. And for Tampa, it's one thing to ride the warmth of being in the middle of a game, the adrenaline of being in the middle of a game. That's how a guy like Perry, he went down a little bit. Nick Paul, Kucherov, that's how they stay in the game and they play. What are the next 48 hours going to be like? How sore is Nick Paul and Corey Perry and Nikita Kucherov going to be tomorrow morning? What about tomorrow afternoon? What about tomorrow night? What about when they wake up on the day of game 4? I don't know the answer, and I don't think they do either. Honestly, someone explain how a team gets destroyed 7-0, then proceeds to destroy that same team 6-2 the next game. What? First time? Hockey. That's why you watch the games. So, that is it for this edition of Cup Check. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really like to tell all your friends. Game 4, Wednesday.